Well, first of all, thank you very much to Tom and to his colleagues for the invitation to the party. This has been fantastic. And I'm so glad to be here, and just to say at the beginning of my talk that it's the work of so many people, and Tom has been an absolute sort of paradigm in that, that are allowing structural biologists now to just do the most amazing things in terms of focusing on biology. As Ian said, you know, I'm not going to be raising the knowledge much in this talk and talking about how we actually did the structures, but that's because we've got the tools to do them. It's fantastic. So thank you. Now, I'm going to tell you a story. And maybe some of you, I'm sure a lot of you, have been to visit Daniel Rosbesky's poster. And in a sense, then, this, you see, this is one of these kind of murder mysteries, therefore, because you've seen the denouement. You've seen the crime scene. And now we're going to wind back to the beginning. We're going to start the story and then run forward and we'll see how we got there and who the cast members were and how they all contributed. Right, off we go. I'm going to talk about guidance cues. And some of you have heard me talk about them before. For those of you that haven't, you probably don't know what a guidance cue is. Well, I'll start the story 100 years ago. But I wasn't there then. But using the best tools that he had developed at that time, Ramon, and I'm going to actually massacre the name, I apologize, Ramon y Cajal used the best imaging of his day to look at what was going on in a pigeon cerebellum, so part of the pigeon brain. And he saw, to hark back to Tom Blundell's story, complexity. He saw this exquisite complexity of the wiring up of the nerves, the outgrowths from the, what we now call the neuronal bodies in the cerebellum. And when he looked at that, he said, okay, this complexity doesn't happen by chance. These outgrowths, as he would call them, must be guided to the correct place. There must be guidance factors at work. Now, over the decades, then, people sort of started to poo-poo that idea. No, is it? Things just sort of, they just kind of grow out, and then they get somewhere, and then they just decide they're going to do the right thing. But by the 90s, by 1990s, people like Marc Tessier-Levine, Corey Goodman, said, no, this must be right or wrong. Surely there must be guidance cues. And they were set out to look for them, and they found them. They found four main families of guidance cues. And I'm going to tell you about one of them, and what we've been discovering about the molecular level, how it works. And that guidance cue family is the semaphorin family. And I wanted to start working on this sort of area pretty much from the minute I started reading the papers about these guidance cues in the mid-90s. It took me, you know, 2 or 3 years to convince a funding organization to give me some money. So we went forward to about 2000. And then we started making these guidance cues in my lab. And the first guidance cue that we made, we sent to Alain Chapelle, who very kindly lived in Paris, who very kindly ran what was called a stripe assay. Now, if you take dorsal root ganglion explant, that's what that is there, it'll send out little neurites, it'll grow out, you put it on a lamin substrate, oh, it'll come out, grow out all directions. And that's what these is, you've got a red dye there showing them. But if you take, in this case, a semaphorin, Sema-4D that we made in the lab, and you coat the green tracks with the semaphorin, now the explant outgrowth sticks rigidly on track, away. It actually gets repelled. It avoids going, treading on the areas where there is the semaphorin. So it's a repulsive effect. And you can imagine that at work, actually, in this wiring up system, that you're keeping things on track by this very process.
turns out it's not just a process that's driving the development and wiring up of the nervous system. It's important then in many other aspects of the nervous system, including the adult, but also in many other organs, in vascular patterning, generally in organogenesis, in immune cell differentiation and function, and in tumorigenesis. So I'm just going to talk mainly about broadly applicable principles of the mechanism of action of this system, although often the assays are alternatively, tends to be with the neuronal people. Right, so what was known at the beginning? Well, what was known was that the semaphorins were characterized by a cell domain. You could see it in the sequence. They didn't know what it was, they just knew. They called it a cell domain. And they showed it by this rather handsome lemon cover here. And you can see the semaphorins, and now here I've just shown the main classes of semaphorins from vertebrates. You've got a secreted class, the SEMA3s, and then you've got a range of different cell surface attached classes. And apart from the SEMA domain, and this little chappy here, which is a PSI domain, you can have a number of other things between the SEMA domain and where the chain then moves into the cell. Now, the receptors of the SEMA domains are the plexins, and confusingly, they also have SEMA domains. See them again in the sequence. And there's another character here. He's neuropilin. We'll come back to him. He's going to look in the background for a little while. Now, the plexins are capable of signaling in a number of different ways, a lot of which we don't understand at the moment. But one of the key things that they can do is that they have a gap domain. And that gap domain actually it talks mainly to RAP. Okay, but there's quite a number of other ways that they can signal. There's only one big thing to do there yet. So, the first thing we did was look at what a semidomain looks like. And that was the work of Chris Love, who joined the lab in the early 2000s. And Rob Besnoff came in and did some heavy lifting in terms of some computational stuff, because he's an observatory structure determination. But then we and other labs over the years have done quite a number of these semaphore structures. And what every one of them shows is a lovely seven-bladed beta propeller, a PSI domain, that is just a cysteine knot type domain, and then depending on what else, what kind of might have an IgE domain. But the key thing is that they're all dimers. Very simple message. They're dimers. It took us a while to sort out what a plexin looked like. So we have to fast forward now to 2010. Bert Janssen had strode into the lab. Fantastic, fantastically talented postdoc now in his own lab in Utrecht. And Bert, first of all, was able to sort out the expression problems that we've been having to produce plexin. He made a range of different constructs, but the first one that he really focused on was the top half, let's say roughly half, of plexin. Because plexin, ectodomain, has got 10 domains in it. Right. But we know from the functional literature that the SEMA domain at the top is where a lot of the action is. So we wanted to get that to begin with. And then got the structure. And right from the beginning, you could see it was behaving physically, it was behaving as a monomer. And sure enough, it was a monomer in the crystals. Which was a bit of a surprise, actually. There were all sorts of theories out there that about how plexins were dimers, and that there were interesting things that were going to happen when the semaphorins interacted with the plexin. No, they're monomers. And sure enough, the way that the semaphorins, we then went on to do the complex. And in fact, to do two complexes, because Ross Robinson joined in. And so Bert was able to do a complex of a plexin A, interacting with its semaphorin, one of its semaphorin ligands, the semaphorin 6. And Ross was able to do plexin B1, interacting with our own favorite semaphore D. And this one's exactly the same thing. Okay, there's some extra bits according to which semaphorin you've got attached. But if you look here, If you look at the rotating frame, you just wiped out another pointer. Yeah. If we just look at the rotating movie here, you can see that you've got the semaphore and dial essentially just grabbing hold of two plexus. It's nice and simple. So that sort of tells you, well, there might be something rather important about it being a dimer in terms of signaling there. Okay, we knew what a semaphore in interface looked like. We were able to, for some of the semaphores, stabilize a monomeric form of next mutations. Keep it happy as a monomer. It was still happy. If we did bicore, we could see that it was still entrapped in plexin. That was fine. And then we went to collapse assay. And this was first developed in the lab by Christian Bell. And I hear you ask, what is collapse assay? Well, if you're a cross-set cell, a large sort of pancake-type cell, sitting quite happily in a Petri dish, minding his own business, and you get transfected with plexin B1, which we've lit up here in green fluorescence. You're still happy, you're sitting there. And then, if you add, in this case, some secreted semaphorin that we've made, the 74D, as wild type, so as dimer, whoa, this is nasty, because you're immediately getting cell repulsion effect in all directions. So now, it's sometimes called a rounding assay or a collapse assay, but it has a pretty dramatic effect on your actin cytoskeleton. And as you can see, the cells kind of sort of dribble up and some of these sort of round up. Very dramatic, and it happens to all of them, pretty much, as you can see from this histogram here. We're nearly at 90% in terms of cells collapsed in the Petri dish. If we add a monomerized semaphorin, now remember that still interacts with plexin. Look, they're perfectly happy. They just sit there, still being happy pancakes. You can ramp up the concentration until it's pretty much solid monomeric semaphorin that you're just sprinkling on top of the cells. They're perfectly happy. So to actually trigger a signal, you need the semaphorin to be a dimer, at least to trigger this cell collapse. What's it doing? Well, there's some controversy in the field for a little while after that, but by now I think we're pretty clear that, and this is there's some work from my lab, some work from Matthias Bach's lab, but really Zhou Zhang's lab in Texas was absolutely central to this work. So a number of us have done structures of the cytoplasmic, the gap to it, for the plexin. And in the crystal structure, it was always monomeric. And it sounds in my lab, it was always monomeric, whatever we did to it, whatever concentration we took it to. And the structures showed a kind of closed off active site. So there's no way the RAC, in my view, could be able to access that active site. And what Zhang's colleagues showed was that if you force dimerization, then you get an opening up of the active site. And what is required for that is down to the juxtamembrane segment. There's a shift in position of that. And we think what's actually going on is that there's a coil-coil formation up here, triggered obviously by dimerization on the outside. Great. Okay. So that's the simple story. He was very happy when this was reviewed in 2015. I've got a semaphorin, add it to a plexin, dimerizes the plexin, juxtamembrane, segment shifts, bring together the two gap domains, activity, off to go. Well, there had been, a little while before that anyway, one sort of large fly buzzing around in the soup. And that, if you remember, I said that there was a co-receptor, one particularly well-known co-receptor called neuropilin. Well, originally, neuropilin wasn't a co-receptor. Neuropilin was the receptor. When Alex Glotkin and colleagues were first looking for the receptor for SEMA3, they found that it talked to neuropilin. Genetics. Right. Okay. It was only subsequently with the other semaphorins that people said, no, it's talking to plexin. And indeed, it made more sense that it would signal through Plexit. And this would be much that you could signal through the neuropilin. But people went back, and yet Plexin was had to be there on the cells for the SEMA3 to signal. But it didn't seem to want to talk to the Plexin. It had to talk to the neuropilin. Okay. Well, this is a bit strange. Now with transaminascus in the lab for... Okay, let's have a look at this. So he made some neuropilin, the first four domains, which were known to be sufficient for and biology. And indeed, if we look at the biocore, we could confirm what the neurobiologist has been telling us, which is that you have your plexin, you have your SEMA, SEMA3A, secreted SEMA, and they don't talk to each other. Not at the level that you can measure in the biocore. You can take a neuropilin, and yes, the SEMA formaldehyde. You can take your plexin, and it will also bind to neuropilin. So if you now add the SEMA3A and the neuropilin together, now you're talking, now you're getting an additive effect and getting a written strong binding to plexin. So we first made that contrast, crystallized it, did the structure, and now it makes sense. So in fact, what you've got is a SEMA4in, same dimer SEMA4in, still binding two plexins, grabbing hold of two plexins, but it's obviously not much of a grab anymore. So it's a really weak one. But it's the same sort of interface, just a really weak interface. And it needs to be strengthened by the neuropilin. Neuropilin comes in, and it's able to, because it can bind the SEMA and bind the plexin, the SEMA4in and the plexin, it binds subunit 1 of the SEMA4in dimer, and then it binds the plexin that's interacting with subunit 2. So it really does tie together the complex. Here's a little movie. As you can see, it just sort of stuck in there. You might be asking, hang on a minute, there's only one domain there. Yes, that's the internal domain in the neuropilin. We don't know what happened. We think we've still got the other three domains in the crystal structure, and there's enough space for them to be flapping around in the breeze. They don't seem to be contributing. And there is, in fact, a flexible link between the internal domain and the other three. Right. I'm not sort of talking through at each stage the data that we've got for mutagenesis, because every time I'm talking about interfaces and things, we've always done extensive mutagenesis. We've done biophysical assays to confirm things. And we've done, often turned either in our own lab or with collaborators, to do functional assays as well. And then I'm very drawn on a wealth of literature as well. And things make good sense. So, I've got to speed up. So there we are. Now we're now fast forwarding to, 2010. And we've got quite a nice story. But people keep saying to me, yeah, but it's all very well that you're saying you've got this dimer and you pull together two copies of the plexin. But, you're not sort of pulling them close together. They're sort of going off at an angle. How's that going to help? How are you actually linking into what's happening in the cytoplasmic region? And there was this other sort of fly buzzing around in the soup. And that was a story out there that there was some sort of way that you could auto-inhibit, the plexin auto-inhibited itself. A little bit of data out there to indicate that. So anyway, Bert, this is just before he left, thought, well, I'll just try and sort out this question of what the rest of the active domain looks like. It was quite a challenge. So if you remember, there are 10 domains, and so Bert made constructs. He actually made constructs of plexin A1, plexin A2, and plexin A4. Plexin A3 didn't express very well. And he crystallized all of them, but they were terrible crystals. They were all terrible crystals, and I mean, I'm sure some of you who maybe ever see at the front can see what awful resolution some of them were going to the 10 angstroms. Those of you back, you'll spare that horror. But the one crystal he could see was going to 6 angstroms, and he was able then to use dehydration to get to 4 angstroms. He could do molecular replacement with, if you remember, he got the first four domains. And he could see then that there was clearly a ring arrangement. And in fact, he could see that for all of them. where you can't see the timing is because there's too much flexibility in the latter, the sort of second half of the molecule, and it's just sort of washing out within the structure. But that was that really wasn't going to be final. And anyway, for reasons that I'll come to, we were interested, particularly interested in bits of the stalk. So Yoshin joined the lab, and with Thomas Malinowski's help, sorted out high-resolution, decent, you know, 2 angstrom or better structures for the missing bits of the stalk, which Bert was then able to put back into the structure, get a nicely refined structure for his 4 angstrom using jelly body restraints, and use that then to refine the other, even, you know, poorer resolution structures using Phoenix as single domain rigid body refinement with single B factor per domain. So he's avoided in Doma fit. And very nice it all looks. But is it true? Well, obviously we always see rings in the crystal structures, but we also see them as the predominant species in negative stain EM. So over sort of 65% of the class averages that we were getting would really match up rather well with the crystal structure. Now, so we've got this ring. But the other thing, and thanks Randy for mentioning the fact that I have a tendency to look at crystal contacts, and indeed sometimes for my molecules, these cell surface receptors, they reveal very interesting behavior. And so this rather jumped out at us, because if you remember Bert, in trying to sort out the structure of the ectodomain, it ended up with a whole cupboard full of structures, albeit low resolution. It was still sufficient to see very clearly that they always had the same contact. Different crystal forms, so we're not talking about the same crystallization, different crystal forms, different plexins, plexin A1, A2, and A4, but always the semaphorin domain would be headbutting the stalk of the neighboring plexin. Okay, we noticed, I'm going to talk about most of this slide, but we did kind of go away and look at the sequence conservation, and across plexin A's, there's very high conservation in that patch where we could see this head to stalk contraction. So, a fragment that Yoshin had made, there was a reason why she'd made it, not just for doing that high resolution crystal structure, because we were now intensely interested in this bit of the stalk. And sure enough, if you just take a fragment, which is the semi-domain and PSI domain, so the N-terminal bit of the plexin, and you check whether it binds to that bit of the stalk biophysically, either in, here I'm showing the cytoplasmic resonance, but actually we've done analytical simplification, we've done MALS. Yes, it's very clearly there, we can bind it. And then we can put in the mutation and get rid of it. So it matches what we're seeing in the crystal. Okay, so that, you say, that's all very well, that's just in biophysics, that's just in solution. What's really happening in the cell surface? Well, we could sort of imagine how maybe 2 or 3 of these things could indeed be interacting in this way in the cell surface. I wondered whether it was actually a way of building up larger clusters, because I'd seen that in a different cell guidance system, the F system. And so we were really curious to see whether it would build up clusters. And we used a technique, D-Storm, localization microscopy, to look to see if there were individual molecules for clustering. And we couldn't see any of them was really clustering. So it looked like it was a much, much smaller sort of one-to-one sort of interaction. And we turned to Fred Flynn, so fluorescence lifetime imaging techniques. So here, if you think about it, you've got your donor, fluorophore, and then if it's talking to the acceptor, its lifetime of fluorescence will be impacted. And that's how we did the measurements. Methods. I'm sorry for another complicated slide, but but what we've got here, if you just take a plexin and you have the donor attached, then this is the lifetime, this black line, this the shape here. This is the fluorescence lifetime of a donor when there's no acceptor around. Now you add in a receptor, plexin with receptor on it as well, and and you get a shift. That's that red curve in the lifetime. So that shows, indeed, at the cell surface, there is some sort of interaction between plexins. Is it the interaction that we think it is, the head to stalk, but we can introduce our mutation. And yeah, we don't go right back to the black line, but we greatly decrease that shift in the red line. Okay. If we now add semaphorin in, which we're thinking is dimerizing, well, interestingly, for the wild type plexin, we don't really shift things very much. It's already sort of almost, you know, pre-associated before the ligand is added. But for the mutant form that isn't really pre-associated, once you add ligand, sure, it comes back together. Right. We thought it would be nice to publish that in Neuron, and the editor of Neuron thought it's a lovely story, you know, some of the referees. But she did rather wistfully, in that sort of wistful way that editors do, say, could you get a picture of a neuron? So anyway, so we wanted to demonstrate that this is actually biologically relevant. And to do that, we turned to Hiroon Pasternak. Actually, no, I'm sorry, I shouldn't include this bit at the top of the slide. We turned now to growth cones of dendritic gyri from animal cells from the hippocampus of the mice. Not pigeon, cerebellum, but actually, way back, you know that picture from 100 years ago? Well, that is a granular cell. Can you see it putting out the processes? Well, that's because it had got growth cones. And growth cones have on them expressed, obviously, at wild type native levels, plexinase. So what we did was to take our fragment of the stalk and add it. Now think about it. That fragment is going to then, we predict, bind to the serotonin of the plexin and stop it sort of headbutting its neighbours. So it would stop that sort of particular arrangement of the plexin on the cell surface. And do you know what we got? We got collapse. And if we put the mutant form in, which shouldn't be making interaction with the semi-domain anymore, it carried on, the growth cone remained perfectly happy. So what we think that's telling us is that at the cell surface we've got plexins that are already sort of pre-packaged, hanging around together. But they're actually hanging around together in a way, because of this rigid ring structure, that they don't come close enough to the juxtamembrane regions and the transmembrane helices don't come close enough to allow the cytoplasmic regions to engage. And you need the dimerization, this is modeled by the dimerization of the ligand to reorientate the rings in such a way that they will then pull together and trigger the signal. How long are we doing for time? 2 minutes. And it was all lovely. But, first of all, this is now all on published data. Yoshin has gone on, she's done another structure, she's done a structure of plexin D1. It's a ring again, that's good. And interestingly, we can get that high resolution. Do you know why? Because in the lattice, the rings interlock. And in fact, what we don't see in the lattice is that head-to-stalk interaction. And we were that kind of figures because that patch isn't conserved in the head to, in, on the stalk of the deep plexins. So I don't know what it's doing. Deep plexins must be doing something different. But if you've been to Daniel's poster, you'll know that the fly semaphorin system that he's been looking at, we got a bit of a surprise. Because in fly semaphorins, they really want to make the dimers. Flies, they've got four sorts of semaphorins, and three of them, they actually disulfide bridge in the semi-domain to lock two semi-domains together to make the semaphorin a dimer. But one of them they don't. And we never really noticed this in the sequence. Nobody noticed it. But semi-1b doesn't do that. And not only does it not do that, it doesn't hang together at all as a dimer. It's a monomer. It's very much a monomer. It's a monomer in the crystal structure. It binds to plexin A, the fly plexin, as a monomer. And fly, we haven't got the whole structure of the plexin A actinomain for fly, but again, it's a really nice structure. And that's a bit of a problem, because if you take Daniel's second crystal form, you can see that the Sema 1B, fly Sema 1B, can make two sorts of interactions with plexin, with the fly plexin. And if the fly plexin is, if you model it as a full ring, that second interaction is a direct clash. That's that here, you can see. The red and the blue is a clash. Well, it's not real, it's in a crystal. No, it's real. Daniel can show it's real. It happens at the cell surface. That interaction is occurring. It happens as well, in biophysical classes. Oh, it's there. So it came up to me. And my favorite structure is the ring. That's what I mean about this is a murder mystery. My favorite structure has been murdered because I really like the idea of it always being a ring. And it's not. It's really nice. He's done fret by sensor. Assay, and he can show that if you add Sema 1B to your plexin, where you're predicting that you're going to be getting fret because it's a ring, you add Sema 1B, the ring breaks open, you lose fret. Add a mutant form of Sema 1B that would predict would no longer be able to break the ring apart because of making this sideways on interaction, and sure enough, you restore fret. So we think, from the biology, and this is now these experiments are now going to go into fly with a collaborator, Greg Bashaw, that what's happening is, in cis, so on the same cell surface, in fly, Sema 1B is acting to in some way open up the plexin to allow it to potentiate its interaction with the true dimeric plexin, Sema 4 and Sema 1A. And there's something else. I think this might be going on in mammalian cells as well. Because actually, you remember I said, I just slipped it in, it's 60-65% are in the ring-like conformation when we looked in negative stain EM at our original plexin A, our mammalian plexin A. Well, the other sort of 30 or so, or 25% of the class averages, are in what we call this chair conformation. So it's the ring does seem to have just one pivot point to open. We don't know when it opens, why it opens. We think in some cases this might be very important in cis interactions and cis signaling and in further control and modulation. And I talked too long, so I'm just going to tell you that all the people who contributed, major contributors, I've mentioned en route and shown their pictures. But this is just also mentioned some absolutely key members of my lab who run all the tissue culture, Wei Xian and Yu Guan, Carl Harlos for the crystallography, Reiner who helped with the super resolution stuff, Sergi who heads up our advanced cellular imaging facilities and did help with all the fret, Rob Gilbert who helped on the negative stain EM, and a whole load of collaborators over the years on the functional side. Thank you very much.
But I still don't understand how this kind of signaling actually guides the growth.
Yeah, and to be honest, we still have, nobody has really joined up all the dots inside the cell. Now there's clearly signaling that ends up as disassembling the actin cytoskeleton. Very localized signaling, so it's kept very, very local. So if you imagine your growth cone coming along, if you usually you've either got gradients of secreted semaphorin, or you've got the cell attached, so they'd be coming on this side, say, and you collapse your actin cytoskeleton. Now, but in some way, you must also be rebuilding on this side. Now, how are you collapsing it? And I mean, you've also got to have some sort of crosstalk with focal adhesion. And the integrin and things like that. How are you collapsing it? Well, it looked like there was one very elegant solution, that the plexin is talking to a molecule called Michael, and that there was nice evidence for that in the fly. It doesn't seem to be holding up in the vertebrate system. But Michael was then supposed to go away, and in the fly certainly is capable of, as an enzyme, as an activated, it somehow gets activated by plexin, and then goes away
specifically labels particular lysines on the actin and destabilizes the actin and comes apart. And that looked, you know, a really nice direct linkage, but it's not that long holding together terminology. And you might ask what RAP's got to do with that as well.
Consistency of just one pivot point in a structure that looks like it ought to be locally flexible, local positions is interesting. What is the sequence there? Is it conserved across species? Are there no flying indications?
Well, certainly, if we look at the electron density, it seems to be that's the region that's always a bit sort of fragile. High B factors. If you look at the junctions between domains, well, we haven't got a really high resolution structure just spanning that bit. I can't tell you that there's just a couple of key residues that I can see and I'm happy with it. But the rest of it does seem to be pretty rigid, and it's quite surprisingly so. They do seem to be abutting quite tightly. I didn't show close-ups of all the interfaces between domains, but these are all the PSI and IPT domains do seem to lock together quite well.
This may be slightly off topic, but I'm just wondering where the specificity comes in the wiring diagram. I know Larry Zabersky did a lot of great things in software, but in general, in Venezuelans, for example.
That's a good question. Specificity in the wiring diagram. Well, I mean, along the way, you're getting plexins and semaphorins switched on and off in different places. So you're getting told to sort of turn this way or turn that way along the route.
But in terms of actually targeting cells, specific cell contacts?
These are generally driving the formation of layers and sort of tangential movements. And so setting up, I guess you're not sorting an individual, I think it's the efferent Fs that are supposed to be doing more of this sort of one-to-one mapping, but don't ask me how they're doing that even. If you're talking, this sort of actual, very specific wiring up, this one is the one that makes the interaction with this particular synapse. I don't think we really understand that. But we do now understand quite a lot about which semaphorin plexin combinations along with the other cell guidance cues are telling your granule cell to migrate to a particular position. And we can see if you make a mutation in a mouse, then you can see particular cells don't move to a particular place.
Just a word on that. I won't spend time on it, but I believe the equivalent of the D-scan story from Sofala in mammals are the pseudocadherins discovered by Tanyanis and very much worked out by Larry Shapiro and Barry Pointing.
Thanks, Wayne. No, I should have thought of that. Yeah. Okay, absolutely.